Thomas Firsch, who is an assistant professor in geography at the University of Valenciennes in France, and his main research topics concern social and urban geography of southern European cities, focusing on upper classes' mobility and urban practices. He's also interested in geography of family networks and demographic changes. And together with him, we have Camille Schmoll, who is associate professor at the University of Paris Diderot in France. Her main research focuses on gender and generation and the family in the Euro-Mediterranean region. She's now preparing a book on new patterns of female migration in and from Southern Europe. And both of them have been collaborating with other colleagues, among them Adrien Dubuc and Ettore Recchi. And they have been undertaking a research project on new Italian migrations to France in the post-crisis content. They have published several papers and chapters on the topic, among them, Je suis un Italien de Paris, Italian Migrants Incorporation in a European Capital City, in the Journal of Ethnic and Migration Studies. Their paper today is titled Flying Grandparents and Mompreneurs, New Italian Migration, The Case of Young Skilled Italian Migrants in Paris. So, welcome.
Good morning, everybody. So today we will present some results of this research that we have been conducting for 5 years now in Paris about the new wave of Italian migrants in the city, in France and in Paris. We will focus on family and parenthood issues and on motherhood, which is an old issue in migration studies, but which has been underexplored for this new wave of Italian migration. Indeed, in academic studies, this new population outflow from Italy has been described mainly through a brain drain approach as a labor migration in the wake of the 2008 economic crisis. As you can see on the graph that we've made, which is based on the Italian anagrafe, there's a sharp increase of population outflows from Italy a few years, 2 years after the economic crisis of 2008. From 2010, the flows have a sharp increase in all all main destinations. These are the five main destinations, mainly European, and France is one of the top destinations. So with 3,000 entries before the crisis, yearly entries, and now more than 10,000. Okay, so there's a crisis effect. There's a crisis effect on these population outflows, and it's clear that the imbalances of the European labor market plays a very important part in driving, in fostering this new migration. But there's a second field of research that describes these new migrations as lifestyle migrations. The key problem in Italy seems, for these studies, the key problem of these of Italy seems to be a lack of youth recognition, even more than a lack of jobs. Young adults' emigration is fostered by a generational gap in Italian society that makes it difficult for youth to access independence and social recognition, not only by finding a well-paid job, but also by leaving parental home, making a family, getting political visibility. So this new migration is also a way of escaping the so-called long family in Italy, so this long permanence of youth at the parental home. And it's a way of experimenting new kinds of transitions to adulthood. And that's the reason why this new migration is directed to large European cities which, except London, are not all the best places for job opportunities, such as Berlin, for instance, or Barcelona in Spain. But in all these studies, in the labor migration approach, as well as in the lifestyle approach, family, there are very few works deal with family issues. This migration is always described as very individualistic and self-organized. Family channels are said to have been replaced by online communities and academic programs as drivers for this migration. We, in that presentation, we argue that family still matters in that migration. First, because extended family, especially the migrants' parents, is a key support for Italian migrants, giving them material and financial support at their arrival in the host country, but also giving care support when they start a family and settle down abroad. And the proliferating, the growing importance of websites and blogs involving migrants' parents show the key role of the so-called Generation Zero, as Mihaila Nedelcu created this concept of Generation Zero, the parents who are remaining in the home country. So there's a very important role of this Generation Zero in that new migration. So, for instance, that's this blog, Mamme di cervelli in fuga, which is been created in 2 years ago by a Neapolitan mum with two children who have emigrated to London and to the United States, for instance. And so it's a very important issue in the media and on the internet. So, a second reason for this importance of family issues is that there are still an important divide in Europe regarding family patterns. One of our research questions is an old question. It's how far family models and roles are reshaped by international migration. This is an old question of migration studies, but which have been asked only for migrations from the south, from the global south to the global north, or for migration from rural areas to urban areas, as if migration was a transition from more traditional and family-oriented societies to more individualistic societies with a nuclearization process of the family and a more emancipation and a transition towards more equal gender roles and so on. We could see the migration from Italy to France with that modernization paradigm, which is implicit in many migration studies. But we would like to go beyond this modernization pattern, and we would like to show that migration can foster hybrid family patterns and lasting hybrid family patterns, and the repositioning rather than fading of gendered inequalities. If we look, despite the European integration process, the economic and political integration process of Europe, there are still marked differences in terms of family patterns in Europe. We show only these two maps with two indexes. Here is the non-marital birth ratio in Europe. As you can see, Italy has still a very low rate of non-marital birth ratio, and France or Sweden have among the highest rates in Europe. And on the second map, it's the share of young people aged 25-34 still living at their parents' home. It's over 30% in Italy, and just around 10% in France. So that's a big difference. So to put it broadly, Italy is said to belong to a southern European strong family model, where family is seen as a protective institution. So family formation are highly normalized, still centered on the marriage, and the young people leave very late parental home and keep close contacts, very often go and live very close to their parents in the same street, in the same buildings, in independent apartments in the same buildings very often, and so keep close contacts with their kin all along the life cycle. In France, family is seen as a socializing institutions, and so of course it stays important along the life cycle, but with more distant ties. So we could see that migration as a modernization paradigm from traditional Italy to modern France, but actually it's not, and we will show that coming to France and making a family in France can foster new gender inequalities and hybrid patterns between the two models. The Italian strong family model can be seen as another path to modernity, as to quote Marzio Barbali, the sociologist, he speaks of an individual emancipation within the family, not from the family, to describe this strong family model in Italy. So the second question is the role of parenthood as a key moment of migration experience. Parenthood, we used the recent book of the Italian sociologist Manuela Naldini, La transizione alla genitorialità, but the subtitle is interesting. The subtitle is Da coppie moderne a famiglie tradizionali. So she wants to show that the way of making a family in Italy is more modern than it used to be. There are many couples living outside marriage, but when they make a child, there's a retraditionalization of gender roles and family roles and so on. And the migratory experience can reinforce this process. So because it impacts gender relations, that will be the first point of our presentation, by strengthening gender norms. It impacts family solidarities by enlarging solidarities beyond the nuclear family. And it impacts, too, relations with ethnicity and Italianness by fostering a growing incorporation in Paris Italian community. A few words about the methods, and then I'll let Camille speak. We have a mixed method approach. We've made an online survey in the Paris metropolitan area in 2015 with more than 500 respondents, and is investigating the professional assimilation, the residence, the contacts with Italy, the returns, the income, the professional sectors of the migrants, and it's a very precious source, because we are short of stats and figures and official figures about these migrations, which are invisible to French statistics, for instance, because within the Schengen space, the free movement of the space of free movement of the European Union, Italians are not don't have to register at the French Home Office, and they escape official French stats. Then this is the quantitative part of our research. Then we've made 20 in-depth interviews, biographical interviews with young skilled Italian migrants in Paris, and also three multi-sited family monographies, both in Paris and Naples. So we've interviewed the parents in Naples, brothers and sisters for two families too. And so we can see by this multi-sited approach the links between the home country and the destination country. And then we've made a knee ethnography about the website, social networks that deal with family issues, such as Pappe Mamme Italiani a Parigi, which is a Facebook group, the blog Mamme di Cervelli in Fuga, etc. It's a very important activity. And so we included the Generation Zero, the parents, in the research. Okay.
Let's come to the results of the research. So, as Thomas said, not only in Italy, actually, in contemporary European societies, the most important, even in the making of a family, is not anymore moving out from the parents' house or marriage. It's rather the birth of the first child. So when we observe the patterns of cohabitation of Italians in Paris, we see that quite similarly to the French ones, there are various, ranging from the PACS, so that it would be the legal free union, you know, to a de facto union. Most of our interviewees were cohabitating without being married. This combined with rather egalitarian, let's say, ways of thinking about couples. So it's very much in line with a kind of individualization through migration process that we can find in the migration narrative, actually. Yeah? This idea that they perceive their migration to France as a kind of emancipation from the family, traditional family patterns, let's say. And the motivations for living in a free union, on a free legal union, corresponds quite are quite similar to the French motivation. So the idea, especially when you engage in a PACS, is to give a legal framework for a union that already exists, be they gay or heterosexual unions, actually. And actually, even this possibility to enter into a PACS union was perceived by some of our respondents as a motivation for moving to France also, because until 2016, it was not possible to engage in a legal union, in a homosexual union in particular, in Italy. So engaging in a PACS may have corresponded to decision that was already considered in Italy, but not legally feasible. Things change drastically with the birth of a child. So while we don't see many difference between patterns of cohabitation between Italy and France and within the Italian migrants community in France, we see that with the arrival of the first child, there are drastic changes in family roles and identities. So we see a similar transition to the one explored by Emanuela Maldini, as Thomas said, that is the move from modern couples to traditional families. And we see also a very interesting debate going on the web, especially, on the difficulties, but also the thrilling experience of becoming a mum in Paris. So now I'll move to Italian motherhood on the web. So you have plenty of personal websites, online communities devoted to Italian mothers living abroad, and especially in France. This is growing exponentially. Every day we go on the web, we find another one, and it's really interesting. As you can see from the pink picture, not only internet becomes an important sphere for the emphatization of modern motherhood, but also these are profoundly heteronormative spaces. So really, like yesterday we had a presentation which rather focused on the internet as a space for emancipation. But in our case, actually, gender roles are completely being repositioned in a quite traditional way. So first of all, fathers are completely absent from this space. No, to the exception, we have one exception, which is a Facebook group, Papa e Mamme Italiane in Parigi. But I have to say, if you look at the discussions, you have barely, maybe in 1 year we had two papa involved in like 1,000 of discussions. So it's really, really few. So fathers, of course, does not tell us anything about fatherhood and father roles, but it tells us that they are not involved on this kind of communication tools, for sure. Second, there is absolutely no mention of other kinds of just gay parenthood, for instance, is not a debate. It's not an issue. So only heterosexual couples, traditional. And then, yes, as I said already, the presentation, the structure of those websites is highly gendered, pink pages of this kind of, you know, SOS allattamento. So these women, these Italian moms are on these websites are extremely concerned with their children, patterns of well-being of their children and partners. They are very much concerned also with leisure activities connected to the domestic sphere, so the book they will read, cooking, organizing parties, and sometimes walks or promenade around the city. And work, for example, is not really an issue, at least when it comes to traditional waged labor, because we will come back to this afterwards. So it's something that has been already tackled, actually, in migration literature, the issue of the reinforcing of heteronormativity through the migration process. So it's not something new. It has been particularly well described by Karine Duplan when she worked on expats' wives in Luxembourg. But however, the women we study are not expats. they came on their own, many often, to France. So it was really an individual move. So they are not like, reunifying spouses or expat wives. They came on their own, and they came to work to France. So it's quite impressive how becoming a mom changed completely, you know, the frame. And actually, these women fight a lot, and we see it especially through interviews with the representations, the stereotype of the mama, which, as you know, is an ambivalent one, and it's also something quite historically rooted, especially during that has been especially developed during the years of fascism. So, during fascism, motherhood and the return of mothers to the domestic spheres has been glorified. But at the same time, mothers were accused of being too protective, especially with their sons, as suspected to contribute to their weakness and feminization. And in a context in which the stereotype of the strong man was glorified, of course. So still today, we see these women that fight with those paradoxical injunctions. And it's interesting to connect this kind of fight they can have with ambivalent representations of the mom with recent research in demography. Recent research in demography has connected the low Italian fertility. You know that Italy is one of the countries with the lowest fertility rate in Europe, to the high requirement of Italian motherhood. It's difficult to make children when you know that the job of becoming a mom is highly demanding. So it's connected, of course. And conversely, demographers have connected the high fertility in France with the low expectations we have towards motherhood in France. So actually, the Italian mothers we met, they spontaneously make this comparison between the highly demanding task of being an Italian mother and the less demanding task of being a French one. But, however, they don't present the French model as a more modern one, and they are very right, because if in France, you know, the Italian, for instance, this example of Andiamo Mamma blog shows, in Italy, the normativity of motherhood is based on the fact that there are many requirements of being a good mama. In France, there is a very strong normativity of fertility. So if you don't have in Paris, even in Paris, which is not a very family-friendly city today, if you don't have three children, you haven't achieved your mom. It is. I mean, I'm a little bit joking, but at least two. Come on, one is too sad. So it's very different injunctions, but it's very interesting to listen to these women talking about these two systems and how they cope with it. Actually, what we see is that Italian mothers tend to conform rather to the Italian way than to the French. So low fertility, but highly demanding motherhood. So we have a table, but I will we'll go very fast on this because we don't have time, but on the fertility patterns based on the results of the survey. And we see that actually the women we've surveyed conform rather to the Italian way. So they become mother quite late, around 40 years old, which is very late for the French standards, but quite similar to the Italians. And they still keep on with very, very low fertility patterns. This is not surprising, though, because migration studies have shown that actually the move to the fertility patterns of the receiving society comes with the second generation. So it's not surprising at all that women rather conform to the Italian way. So another way of re-strengthening gender norms in terms also of increased gender inequality through migration is the fact that many women, as I told you, they came as worker, first of all, they will exit the formal or the waged labor market. They will exit, and first of all, they will take care of their children. And we see that also in Italian statistics. We know that Italian women in Italy, they tend to exit the labor market with the birth of their child. I'm a bit lost in my notes. What is interesting, however, if we look at this work, is that women will continue to work, but in a different way. And for instance, what is quite striking in our results is that there is an importance of autonomous work, of entrepreneurship among young Italian migrants in Paris, especially for women. Women starting their own business. So this is a way somehow to benefit from the French welfare policies, but also to live upon welfare benefits. It's a kind of ambivalent way of working, but it makes their case as they want also to take care of their children. So it's weird because somehow they are very proud of this. They qualified themselves as mompreneurs. Many often this mompreneur activity will be focused on rather traditional ways of being an entrepreneur. So for instance, Elena will provide yoga courses. Angela will provide French lessons. Isabella is a cake designer. Margherita will teach cucito. Annalisa, she's intellectual, she's a physician, so she will provide scientific activities. Emanuela, piano lessons. Tiziana, catering, and so on. So for these skilled women, motherhood is seen as an opportunity to experiment new ways of working beyond the traditional wage labor market. But it's also a way to bridge the gap between the domestic realm and the productive sphere, of course, caring for children and managing one's business at the same time. So they see business rather as an empowering project, even if they don't make enough money to live off it, and of course, because they become in that way quite dependent of their husband or their partner's income. And I leave the floor to Thomas. So, I don't know if we have some time left. Or...
Okay. Yes, I don't know. Yes, another field, another sphere that parenthood impacts is family solidarities. Paris Italians widely use the French public service and family welfare, but they also rely very much on the support of their Italian extended family to take care of their children in Paris. So there's a moment, the birth of their children is a moment of refamiliarization, a temporary return to the informal support of the extended family in a general trend of individual emancipation and transfer of social protection to the welfare state and the market. Indeed, in the years that follow their arrival in Paris, young Italian migrants often distance themselves from their family of origin. Because, as I said before, their migration is also a lifestyle migration, part of an emancipatory project and a new way of transiting to adulthood. It can be seen as a way of escaping the Italian long family model. But when they have children, refamiliarization occurs. They don't go back to Italy more often than before, but they receive more visits from their parents, and we have showed that statistically in our survey. So Italian grandparents, the so-called Generation Zero, play a key role in that refamiliarization. They come to Paris from Italy often more than four times a year to take care of their grandchildren, often for long periods of several weeks. There are some yearly routine mobilities for school vacations and summertime holidays, but also very fluid and informal circulations according to the needs of the Paris migrant families. As you can see on these extracts of interviews, the grandparents are summoned to Paris, can be summoned to Paris at any time if the family needs. And after the birth of your children, you did not want to move closer to your family? Oh, it's actually the opposite. We import grandparents when they are needed. And this is an interview I've made with Alessandra, a Neapolitan grandma in Naples. She says, I and Isabella's mum as well, we are full-time grandmas. When children need us, we rush to them, be it for a cold, the flu, because they cannot go to school, their parents are working, I come. At any moment. Also because I'm living alone now, so I'm always available. Of course, these fluid mobilities are made possible thanks to the EU integration process. There is no legal barrier to that mobility. There's no visa is needed. And transportation costs are very low because the distance is short, but also there are many low-cost airlines between Paris and major Italian cities. So this is a model which is quite different from the international flying grandmothers that have been described in migration studies, but mainly for migrations from the global south, in the Caribbean diaspora or in the Filipino diaspora. Here, mobilities are very fluid, and grandmothers are implied in the everyday care of the children because they come for long periods, they stay at home with their children for several weeks, they bring children at school, they make the family shopping, they prepare meals, they usually sleep in the their migrant children let them their bedroom and go on the living room sofa for 1 month while their parents, Italian parents, are in Paris. So it's kind of a temporary family reformation, more than a mere family visit. Many Italians in Paris, when they have children, spend 4 months living with their parents a year. So it's a really big difference between the international flying grandmother, which has been described in the migration studies. Another difference is that they move with their husbands. We have made Italian grandparents rather than Italian grandmothers, because these grandparents are coming in couple in Paris, not because only because grandfathers must be. Want to be involved in the care of their grandchildren, but also because their wife don't want to let them alone in Italy because they think no. So they bring them to Paris to take care both of their grandchildren and of their husbands. Okay. So when we map the circulation of these grandmothers, we can see that. Italian migrants in Paris are part of broader circulation care circuits in Europe, because especially for southern Italian families, where immigration is very important because it occurs at the international scale, but also at the national scale in Italy. There's internal migration from south to northern Italy, which is very strong, which has been very strong lately. So many grandparents from southern Italy have all their children who have immigrated, both in northern Italy or in Europe. So for them, they organize European tours. They leave their home for several months a year when they are retired, of course. And for instance, this is the same grandma, Alessandra, from Naples. In 2016, she's made two European tours. One of 2 months, she went to visit her son in Paris for 15 days, then her brother in Köln in Germany for 1 month, and she came back to Naples 2 months later. Then a second long tour of Europe, only for family visits, in the same year. So these circulations are drawing what Florence Weber has called a transnational maisonnée. A maisonnée is a group of people who are sharing their economic resources to face everyday life, even if they don't live under the same roof. And they can include kin, but also extra kin or fictive kin persons, such as domestic workers, for instance. And they often imply members on in two or three or four different European countries. Okay, I let you the last point. I don't know if there's very much time.
Okay. So I would just in order to conclude, our third point, but I will not develop, it was about seeking for the community. As soon as you become a parent, you need more community, and so there are these patterns of plural nationalism that is involving both re-ethnicization through the web or through activities, and anyway, something that is a kind of assimilation to the French community. So plural, we call it, according to following Trianda Filidou, plural nationalism. To conclude, it seems to us that our main finding is that patterns of assimilation when it comes to Italian migrants to Paris are not straightforward. And so we can see that on the one hand, patterns of parenting and especially of motherhood makes you more Italian somehow than you were in the past, but at the same time there are also patterns of assimilation and particularly of incorporation into the city and the French welfare system, which makes you also French in a way. So it's quite ambivalent and complex. And just to say that we still need to explore, because it's much more difficult to explore because they talk less and they are less present, patterns of fatherhood, actually. We really need to look at this in the next few weeks and months, because for the moment we don't have enough to talk about it. And as you've seen, it's kind of completely obscured in our empirical material. And of course, we need to look on the long run at what will become, with how will these family patterns and roles be reshaped by also second generation, but it's too early for the moment. Thank you so much.
First, how would you describe the class status of the people that you study? Because I kept wondering that throughout. And secondly, have you done any research into sort of comparative rates of breastfeeding, or like a pressure to breastfeed, and if that has, changed the motherhood experience at all?
So when it comes to class, actually, it's very interesting because it's connected with the motivations of migration. The Italians we met in Paris, and you just correct me if I'm not right, are part of a huge Italian middle class, very, very skilled, because I don't know if you're familiar with this, but in Italy, it's the only country in Europe in which the higher is your qualification, the less you can find a job on the labor market. Yes. So it's of course connected to this. I mean, it's extremely difficult for young, skilled. So most of them went to university, And interestingly enough, they will not be able, actually, to find on the French labor market. Most often, they will not be able to find a job that will correspond to their skill. But so there is a process of lowerization through migration, if you want. But somehow, they feel it less difficult to do it abroad, as in many migration patterns. I mean, it's a classic, than doing it in Italy. Actually, many of them anticipate the difficulties they will have in Italy. They haven't even, many of them haven't worked yet on the Italian labor market, but they anticipate it would be really difficult to find a job, and it will be a very lowering job if it is, and so they prefer to leave. So it's, I mean, it goes in the sense of what literatures call middling migration process, like a huge middle class. They have different trajectories, but a huge middle class that will in some way lower when they come to France, but at the same time they will find that somehow there is more recognition of who they are and the skills they have than in the country they come, than in Italy. And when it comes to breastfeeding, it's a huge topic of discussion because as we said before, very, very coherently with the French model of motherhood, there is less pressure. Actually, the maternity leave also in France is not as long as in Italy, and there is much less pressure on breastfeeding. So this is a huge topic. It's very much discussed.